It is a busy Friday morning. Let's start in Victoria, where there's a nervous wait for COVID-19 case numbers today, following the highest spike in cases we've seen since the pandemic reached Australia. Let's go to Today Melbourne reporter Isabella Stashkowski. She leads us off. Isa, the state is now under pressure to tighten lockdown restrictions further.
Carl, that's certainly what many are calling for, but it is important to note that could be potentially devastating for businesses right across the state. Now, here in Victoria, we've recorded the highest spike in case numbers since the start of the pandemic in Australia, 317 new cases, two more deaths as well, both men in their 80s. Presently, there are 2,128 active cases, and just under half of those may indicate signs of community transmission. This morning, more than 100 people are in hospital. The old Peter McCallum Cancer Centre, where we are this morning in East Melbourne, has now been redeveloped to help in our COVID battle. 84 new beds are placed here. To free up more beds, we're also seeing a freeze on Category 3 elective surgery. This morning, we are learning that Victorians will now be fined if they exercise outside of their neighbourhood and they do live in a lockdown area. And Carl, in information just coming into the newsroom, it is now mandatory for all aged care workers in those facilities to be wearing a face mask while they are at work. Of course, aged care case numbers have been a major concern here in Victoria.
Yeah, that didn't happen from the start. God only knows. Isabella, thank you.
In New South Wales, the race is on to find the source of three mystery cases. They are two women in their 40s, one in Sydney's west, the other from the southwest, as well as a man in his 30s from the Wollongong area. Those three cases are not linked to the Crossroads Hotel cluster. That outbreak is now sitting at 40. There's a growing list of venues potentially exposed to the virus spreading across Sydney and beyond. The most recent concern, a gym in Campbelltown. And amid all this, six pop-up testing clinics in these suburbs are due to close by the end of the weekend. Let's bring in today's Sydney reporter, Gabrielle Boyle, who's at the Crossroads Hotel. And Gabby, tighter restrictions for pubs, they take effect from today.
They certainly do, Ali. In light of the outbreak we saw here at the Crossroads Hotel in Casula, the New South Wales state government is cracking down on pubs in particular. They'll have 1 week to submit their COVID-safe plan to the state government. There's also tighter specific rules. You'll only be able to book for up to 10 people at a pub, and 300 people will be the maximum, or it will be in relation to that one person per four square metre rule. We're also going to see changes, Ali, to the way sporting events are held here for children in New South Wales. Children will only be allowed to have one parent or carer cheering them on the sideline as of tomorrow. And the New South Wales Police Commissioner is also cracking down on bad behaviour. He's told his officers not to hold back issuing fines to people seen doing the wrong thing. Ali?
Thanks, Gabby.
A 700-metre border wall has been built in Queensland to keep out southerners illegally trying to enter the Sunshine State. Jessica Millwood is on the border at Tweed Heads. Jess, good morning to you. The barrier doesn't seem to be stopping some people, though.
Good morning, Alex. That's right. Queensland police installed the 700-metre border wall along Dixon Street in Coolangatta late yesterday. They did so because people were parking on one side of the street, which was in Queensland, and walking into New South Wales and then going to collect their car. But while we were there early this morning, we witnessed a number of people simply parking their car, jumping over that so-called border wall, and presumably they'll be coming back later today after they finish work. So it doesn't appear to be having its desired effect. What police are really hoping is that checkpoints across the border will start to ease after a new border declaration pass was brought into effect. As part of that, you need to declare that you haven't been to those two hotspots in New South Wales, and there is an expiry date clearly visible on that pass. So they're hoping that that can mean they can start waving some people with New South Wales number plates through. And that is what the residents here on Duckett Street are greatly hoping for. They are really struggling at the moment. The traffic here has been awful for them. They haven't been able to leave their driveways. It is having a great impact on their daily lives. And Alex, shortly we will be speaking to some of them as the traffic here on Duckett Street starts to build. The residents here tell me it gets to a peak at around 8 o'clock this morning. So we'll be chatting to them on the show very soon.
Busy, Jess. Thank you.
Let's have a quick look, if we can, again at how effective those borders are. Here we go. People just There we go, just a... casually jumping over.
Looks like shopping in a hand there, is it? I don't know.
If you know that woman. Well, it's lights, camera, action for Australia. Today the PM will announce a multi-million-dollar boost to bring blockbuster film production to our shores. Federal politics reporter and our entertainment guru, Jono Kersley, is following this story from Canberra with great interest. Jono, good morning to you. He's hoping we'll get our own little slice of Hollywood down under.
$400 million, Carl, to bring film and TV producers and their big-budget projects to Australia. Big-budget film projects, big-budget TV projects, all in the hope that it could create jobs here. The likes of actors, staging crews, lighting, set design, the works. Government money has already been used to bring the likes of Godzilla vs. King Kong and Chris Hemsworth's latest Thor movie Down Under to be made here. But the Prime Minister's focus will be on trying to create those jobs and investment beyond this COVID crisis. Take a Marvel movie, for example, that creates something like 6,000 jobs. And jobs are crucial, particularly at a time like this, because in all seriousness, the country is now facing the highest levels of unemployment since records began back in 1978. More than almost a million people are out of work as the government really tries to stem the flow of unemployment as a result of the COVID shutdowns. The Prime Minister will be joining us on the show very shortly, Carl. But for now, that's a wrap.
Oh, Jono, you've always wanted to say that. Thank you, my man. As Jono said, the PM joins us in about 20 minutes' time. Ali.
South Australian police have sent four stowaways packing, escorting them to a plane back to Victoria after they were caught trying to flee to Perth. Nine's Georgia Westgarth is in Adelaide with the details. And Georgia, their departure, it was quite the spectacle.
It was, Ali. The four stowaways were sent back to Melbourne last night after a trip to court and a night in a city hotel. They did all they could to cover up as they boarded that flight here last night. The four men, all aged in their 20s, snuck into South Australia on a freight train on Monday. They were arrested and avoided conviction, later testing negative to coronavirus, so were sent packing back over the border. It comes as South Australia records its first new coronavirus case in 17 days. An Adelaide woman arriving home from overseas, she returned two negative tests while in isolation in Melbourne, but upon arrival here recorded a very low positive result. Authorities believe she wasn't infectious when she was travelling here and is now in quarantine along with her family. And in a new measure, as of Saturday night, Victorians who refuse mandatory COVID-19 tests here could face fines of up to $1,000.
Georgia in Adelaide, thank you.